Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great pleasure that I stand before you today to share what I consider one of the most revealing insights of my life's journey. Throughout my career, I've had the privilege of delivering countless speeches, sharing wisdom, and guiding individuals on their path to success. But today I want to delve deeper to uncover the essence of what drives us, what propels us forward in our quest for greatness. This speech is not just about imparting knowledge. It's about peeling back the layers of human potential, about unlocking the secrets to personal and professional fulfillment. It's about delving into the core of our being and uncovering the principles that govern our thoughts, actions, and ultimately, our destiny. We will explore the depths of the human psyche, uncover keys to unlocking our full potential, and embark on a path toward becoming the architects of our own destiny. Welcome to one of Ryan Tracy. Welcome to a journey of enlightenment, calmness, and less possibility. Burn more money and more time. Brian Tracy, when it comes to achieving your personal and business goals, money tends to be a major focus for measuring success. The money mindset is essentially your attitude toward cash, so developing a positive mindset about money is crucial for success and overall well-being. To create a positive mindset around money, you must rid yourself of all limiting beliefs that prevent you from taking action, and then start looking at the world through an opportunistic lens to achieve abundance in your life. If you want to discover a positive mindset about money, but what is a positive mindset towards money? If changing your thinking about money is a priority, you'll first want to understand what even is a way of thinking about money. Money mindset is a fundamental attitude you have about your finances. Your mindset about money drives your financial decisions every day. This can have a significant impact on your ability to achieve your goals. It is vital for success to focus on having a positive monetary mindset. While money can be a stressful topic for many, if you change your thinking about money, you tend to make better decisions about how to overcome challenges. Money and mindset go hand in hand. So understanding it, focusing on ways to see it positively, is crucial for lifelong success. But here's the secret. When you fix your relationship with money, you'll transform many other areas of your life. Here are four steps to help you develop a positive money mindset. First, forgive your financial mistakes. If you've never missed a credit card payment or a bill, you might as well be a finance guru. However, for the vast majority, it's important to forgive their financial mistakes. The goal is to shift your focus away from shame and make room for better practices and a more positive attitude toward money in the future. To forgive your financial mistakes, first acknowledge what happened, apologize to yourself, and then focus on moving forward. If you start developing a negative mindset about money, remember that your financial mistakes are not you. You are separate from your past financial mistakes. Second, set financial goals. Once you've forgiven past financial mistakes, setting financial goals can be a significant step toward mastering the monetary mindset. When setting goals, figure out what's most important to you and put everything on the table. You'll want to delve into goals that are within your reach, which will take some time and which should be part of your long-term strategy. Once you've identified these financial goals, apply a SMART goal strategy to ensure that goals are specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and timely. Third, optimize your budget for happiness. Achieving mastery of the monetary mindset is no easy task, but optimizing your budget to include things that make you happy will make it a little easier. If a gym membership or dining out makes you happy, plan your budget accordingly to include these things. If you don't feel deprived, budgeting will feel less like a chore. When budgeting, a good rule of thumb is that 50% of your earnings should go towards needs like housing, food, gas, and medicine, 30% towards wants like vacations, and finally learning to play an instrument, and 20% should be saved. If you have debt, the 20% can be allocated to paying it off first. Fourth, educate yourself about money. Lastly, if you want to have a positive mindset around money, educate yourself about money. Surround yourself with people who live by those values. Read books that promote positive mindsets. And make sure your social networks don't promote negativity around money and spending. It's good to have money and the things money can buy. But it's also good to make sure you don't lose the things money can't buy. George Lorimer said, to be fully rounded as a person, you need to know the importance of time management. You and your quality of life require a worldview that recognizes time as an invaluable, indispensable, and irreplaceable ingredient of a successful, happy, and highly productive life. You need an attitude toward time as something more than the clock or the calendar. Get rid of all your time wasters. Time is the most precious currency we possess, and it's crucial to safeguard it with the utmost care. Every moment lost is an opportunity missed. And as such, we must employ our intelligence to maximize our use of time and seek to expand it whenever possible, leaving no room for wasteful endeavors. One effective strategy is to leverage financial resources to buy back time. Money may come and go, but time is irreplaceable. Therefore, it's prudent to delegate low-value tasks to others, freeing ourselves to focus on activities that truly matter. Be it spending quality time with loved ones, pursuing our passions, or driving our professional endeavors forward. If you're deciding to make quotas to 25 per 4, then any task not yielding at least this amount should be delegated. By outsourcing tasks that can be done more efficiently by others, we reclaim valuable hours to invest in endeavors that yield greater returns, both personally and professionally. Moreover, extending the principles of effective time management to our personal lives is equally crucial. Just as successful executives optimize their professional time, they should also apply the same rigor to their personal domains, ensuring that every moment spent contributes to a fulfilling and enriching life for themselves and their loved ones. They encourage them to hire housekeepers, gardeners, and personal assistants to do chores and run errands. They buy their freedom to be able to enjoy a better quality of life and spend more time with family and personal activities. The reward for both parties is often extraordinary. Improve your time management skills. Keep track of how efficiently you use your time. The more you think about how you're spending your minutes and hours, the better and more accurate you'll be at time management. Because they don't control the use of time, most people aren't even aware of how much time they waste every hour. Get a wristwatch with an alarm that goes off every 15 minutes. Every time the alarm goes off, stop and observe yourself. Look at what you're doing at that moment, if possible. Keep track of time and write down what you're doing. Every time the alarm goes off, regularly ask yourself, is what I'm doing right now the best use of my time? Life is all about attention. The more attention you pay to how you use your time and your biggest time wasters, the more efficient and productive you're likely to be. The more aware you are of the fleeting nature of time, the better you'll use it while increasing your quality of life. Read books. Your feelings about money directly affect your financial reality. While your parents and other external influences have ingrained various types of beliefs about money in your head, the good news is that your thoughts about money can change. The key is to constantly feed your mind with new and positive content that will teach you how to think about money in a completely new way. Books about money, mindset foster positive money spending habits and budgeting, which are imperative for your money mindset training. Inspire yourself with quotes. Surrounding yourself with motivational and informative quotes will help you have the right money mindset. Look for quotes that make you feel good about yourself and your spending and save them on your phone or computer or print them out to have at home. Follow successful people. Stay updated with successful individuals, whether it's on social media, through a blog, or via reliable news outlets. Following successful people will inspire you towards greatness. These individuals don't necessarily need to be public figures. Aim to seek advice only from those who have already achieved what you deserve. These people could be family members, colleagues, mentors, or financial influencers. Whatever the case, it's much easier to follow in the footsteps of someone who's already successful and emulates a positive money mindset. Set goals for a financially successful future. Now that you know how to develop a positive money mindset, start implementing these tips for a more successful future. Setting goals now can prepare you for financial success in the future. Have you ever thought someone was luckier than you or that great things always came their way? Do you believe it's possible to create your own luck? Learning how to be lucky is easier than you think. I'm going to introduce you to 7 of the most useful ways to be lucky, which you can learn. each of these luck factors can quickly be incorporated into your life and can literally double its effectiveness and results in a very short period of time. Now you can create your own luck. One, clarity. The first of these factors for creating your own luck is simply clarity. It simply means you know exactly what you want and is perhaps the most important luck factor of all, at least in the beginning. The more defined you are about what you want, the more alert and aware you'll be of opportunities and possibilities to achieve it faster. Be absolutely clear about what you want. All successful people are absolutely clear about who they are and what they want and what they need to do to get from wherever they are to where they want to go. Unhappy and unsuccessful people, on the other hand, are usually quite confused about what they stand for and believe and what they really want in their lives. As the old saying goes, you can't hit a target, you can't see. Lucky people seem to have very clear goals and the steps they all have to take to achieve them. Write down everything you want to accomplish in the next 12 months. One of the simplest things you can do to change your luck is simply take a sheet of paper and write down a list of at least 10 things you want to achieve in the next 12 months. This doesn't seem like a very complicated exercise, but less than 3% of adults will engage in this exercise in their lifetime. And this 3% will end up at the top of all organizations or companies they work with. It has been said that success and prosperity begin with you, a pen, and a piece of paper. The 97% of people walking around today have no goals. The mere act of putting pen to paper and determining the 10 things you want to achieve over the next 12 months immediately moves you into the top 3% of people living today. All you need are 3 to 5 minutes. Think about what you want and how to get it. Here's an important part of how to be lucky. Lucky people are those who, when they hear a good idea, ask themselves, how can I get it? Unlucky people, on the other hand, when they hear a good idea, like writing down 10 goals, always ask themselves, will this do anything? The difference between lucky and unlucky people is that lucky people always ask how. When the lucky person thinks about something they want, they always ask how they can get it or acquire it. The attitude of always asking seems to trigger both their subconscious and unconscious minds to constantly see possibilities and get ideas that will help them achieve it. But when you ask if it seems to shut down your creative capabilities in your brain, there's a small finger-shaped organ called the reticular cortex. This reticular cortex is like a telephone switchboard that controls the messages that can reach your eyes, ears, and other senses. Since you're bombarded by hundreds and thousands of messages from all sides continually, this cortex allows you to focus and concentrate on those elements of your environment that are relevant or important to you and ignore the rest. For you and ignore the rest, the reticular cortex is activated with a clear goal, order, desire, or even fear on your part. For example, if you decide you want to buy a red sports car and are really excited about the possibility of a red sports car, you'll start noticing red sports cars everywhere. Even that same car turning the corner 2 or 3 blocks ahead of you will be picked up by your reticular cortex and transmitted to your conscious mind. Are successful people just luckier than the rest of us? The truth is, successful individuals train their minds to recognize opportunities and possibilities that align with their goals, effectively programming their reticular cortex to be more attuned to such prospects. On the other hand, those who perceive themselves as unlucky or unsuccessful tend to believe that their goals are unattainable, inadvertently signaling their reticular cortex to disregard potential opportunities. You may even look as a dimmer switch in a dark room. As you cultivate absolute clarity about your goals and aspirations, this metaphor called dimmer switch gradually brightens, illuminating the path to success with greater clarity and precision. With each step taken towards your objectives, the once murky dartboard of opportunity becomes vivid and unmistakable in its clarity. Your likelihood of hitting the bullseye on such a dartboard is much higher than if you were throwing darts from afar, distance in a dark room. The second luck factor is the activity factor. High levels of activity, especially proactivity, increase the number of things you do, and therefore immediately increase the probability of you doing the right thing at the right time and in the right way. For example, if you won a prize, once you flipped 100 heads in a coin flipping contest, the best way to ensure you won that prize would be to flip the coin as many times as possible in the shortest period of time. And if you did and won the prize, it wouldn't be a matter of luck at all. It would simply be a matter of how frequently you attempted to flip heads. Activity begins with an attitude of self-reliance because all high-performance men and women are extremely action-oriented and extremely self-reliant. They look to themselves for solutions to their problems. They realize that no one is coming to the rescue. When you see yourself as completely in charge of your own life, your own career, your own health, your own family, and your own finances, you stop looking for others to do things for you. You start moving forward instead of making excuses. You accept that you are where you are and what you are because of yourself. If you want to be or do something different, it's up to you to make the necessary changes starting right away. If you want to have more luck, develop a bias for action. Develop a sense of urgency. Take action. Get to work. Move fast. The faster you move, the more energy you have. The faster you move, the more experience you gain. The faster you move, the more results you'll get and the more success will come. 3. Mastery. Another excellent way to have good luck is mastery. And it always has been. Knowledge and know-how are the keys to success. You will always be paid in direct proportion to what you do, how well you do it, and how difficult it is to replace you. We have moved from the era of labor to the era of mental power. Your level of knowledge and skill in your chosen field will determine your luck and success in that field as much or more than any other quality. Become a master in your field. Today, people are not paid for their position or seniority, but for their performance and results. The better you are, the more luck you will have. Your job is to decide to join the top 10% in your field and then pay any price and invest the time necessary to get there. The luck factor of mastery can do more to help you achieve great success than perhaps any other factor. On the other hand, you can have all the opportunities in the world, but if you're not really good at what you do, the opportunities will slip through your fingers. 4. Energy. Energy is another key way to have more luck. All successful people seem to have much more energy than unsuccessful people. They get up early in the morning and start faster. Work more hours during the day and night. Invest time in themselves and their careers during evenings and weekends. Writer Stephen Leacock once said in a quote about good luck, "I believe in luck. And the harder I work, the more luck I have." The more you work, the more you do. The more you do, the more you will attract the attention of people who can open doors for you and help you ascend even further and faster. There's nothing like a reputation for hard work to put you on the fast track of any career you choose. 5. Personality. Personality is key to learning and being lucky. The more positive, optimistic, and cheerful you are, the more people will want to be around you and help you in any way they can. Lucky people also tend to be happy and positive individuals. They get along well with others and have broad networks of friends and contacts in a variety of different areas. The more people you know and who know you positively, the more likely you are to meet the right person at the right time to open the right door to the right opportunity. You'll find that almost every lucky incident in your life seems to be accompanied by a person who is standing there at that moment, either with advice or with a hand on an open door. The entire lives of many people have changed because of a casual remark, or a friendly acquaintance who has given them a key piece of information, or an opportunity that has allowed the lucky individual to progress more in a couple of years than many people do in their lifetime. The word most frequently used to describe successful people is the word nice. Let's talk about the power of character and integrity. When you consistently demonstrate goodness and kindness, you'll find that people are naturally drawn to support you. At the core of this lies the timeless principle of treating others as you wish to be treated. By embodying positivity, you activate the law of attraction, attracting circumstances and individuals aligned with your best interests. It's a simple equation. The kinder you are, the more fortunate you become. 6. Honesty and integrity. These qualities aren't just admirable, they're essential for building meaningful relationships and effective leadership. Think about the people you admire and trust the most. They're likely individuals of unwavering integrity. Shakespeare captured the sentiment eloquently in the phrase, "To thine own self be true." Being authentic and truthful with yourself forms the cornerstone of personal integrity. In business, honesty and integrity are non-negotiables, serving as the bedrock of success across industry. Now let's discuss 7. Intensity, a defining trait of highly successful individuals. In any competitive arena, those who demonstrate unwavering dedication and persistence often emerge victorious. The more fervently you pursue your goals, the more likely you are to uncover the necessary strategies for success. This means putting in the extra hours, exploring various avenues, and continuously expanding your knowledge and skills. With intensity and perseverance as your allies, you become an unstoppable force, capable of overcoming any obstacle in your path. When you become a positive and cheerful person, known for your high character and integrity, you put yourself on the side of the angels. And when you back every desire and goal with unwavering confidence and persistence and keep moving forward no matter what adversity, you will turn out to be one of the luckiest people in the world. You make your own luck, create the life you want, and as a result, your future will be limitless. A boy becomes a man when a man is needed. I've seen 40-year-old boys because a man was never needed. You're about to hear a life-changing speech from Brian Tracy. Relax, take notes, and watch this entire video so you don't miss anything that could have a big impact on your life. Taking control of your life is one of the most important decisions you'll make. From childhood, we're conditioned to see ourselves as children with children. There are other people in charge of our lives, making decisions for us, telling us what and when to eat, when to go and when to come, buying us clothes, taking care of us, and so on. We're conditioned, and if we're not careful, we're conditioned to believe that other people provide for us, make decisions for us, and tell us what to do. Most people never get over this. They never make the transition from child to adult. When they grow up, they think someone else should take care of them. A boss, an employer, and worst of all, a government. The government should provide for me, and I don't care how they do it, but I think they should take care of me. So we remain as children all our lives. Steck wrote a book many years ago that I was asked to study in high school. It talks about a young man who now has to make a big decision, and his friend says, "But he's just a boy." He replies, "A boy becomes a man when a man is needed. I've seen 40-year-old boys because a man was never needed." And it's the same. A woman becomes a woman when a woman is needed. There are women in their 40s and 50s, because a woman was never needed, they would always look to someone else. So we say the motto of the fully responsible person is, if it is to be, it's up to me. We don't look to other people as solutions to our problems. As Henry Ford said, never complain, never explain. In other words, if you're not happy with something, change it, but don't complain. Complaining is a sign of weakness, but it's also a sign of victimization. A person who complains is basically saying, I'm a victim, I'm weak, I'm small, I'm ineffective, I'm a child, please pity me. And what this does is undermine your self-esteem. It simply takes away all your motivation and self-confidence. Even the choice of words can be very detrimental. We say there's a deep valley between maturity and immaturity called the valley of excuses. And this is one of my contributions. We say that in life you come to a valley and a canyon where the valley is childhood and immaturity, and on the other side is adulthood and maturity. Where this is the canyon, you come to this point and you have to make a decision to make the big leap. But what most people do is they timidly take the leap and try to cross the canyon of excuses. They try to cross it in two jumps and end up in the valley of excuses. The valley of excuses is one of the biggest obstacles to success in adult life. We make excuses often. I say that 80% of the population goes to someday island every time they think about a change they want to make in their lives. They think, someday I'll do it. Someday I'll write it down. Someday I'll buy that book. Someday I'll improve my skills. I'll lose weight. I'll get out of debt. And someday I'll change my bad relationship. And so on. And then they end up in the valley of excuses. So your job as a fully functional adult, when you get here, is to make the leap to the other side. And once you've made the leap to the other side, there's no turning back. And this leap of accepting total responsibility for your life is scary, which is why most people don't do it. It's also exciting because it frees you to say, I'm in charge of my own life, I'm the one in charge. So your job is to jump over the valley of excuses, accept total responsibility for your life, and never look back. Looking back, we say that excusitis, which is an inflammation of the excuse-making gland, is invariably fatal to success. The reason people aren't successful is because they have excuses. You can't imagine a leader crying, complaining, and making excuses. As Mark Twain said, there are 1,000 excuses for failure, but never a good reason. So one of the things we do is, there are no more excuses. Either you do it or you don't. Join or jump. But I don't give excuses. We say that accepting responsibility is not optional. It's mandatory. I mentioned it before, but I can't be too emphatic that you can only give up control. You can't give up responsibility. You're still responsible for yourself throughout your adult life. You can give up control by trying to make someone else responsible for your life. And you do. And then you wait to be told what to do or not to do, or you get a raise, or to be promoted or demoted or hired or do something else. Or you can accept responsibility, and accepting responsibility is mandatory. You can't move forward, and you're literally stuck in your tracks, almost as if there's a wall in front of you until you accept responsibility and make the leap and never give another excuse again. We say that the word responsibility can be broken down into two words, response and ability. It's your ability to respond. The challenge response theory in history is a fascinating part of history that I discovered when studying the work of Gunnar Myrdal, who received an award from the Academy for his work. He said that every civilization in history, better point this out, I don't want to rush you, okay, said that every civilization in history started with a small tribe, as small as three people. The history of the Mongols, the Mongol Empire, which was the largest empire in the history of man on earth, stretching from the Sea of Japan to the Danube in Europe and across the Middle East and all of China and half of India, began with three people. Genghis Khan, whose name was Temujin, they were three. They tried to be eliminated. They encountered the Gobi Desert and hid. What Temujin did was look for the tribe he was part of, and so on. What happens is that every tribe, every group, became an empire, starting with a major challenge they had to respond to effectively. Well, this was a major challenge. The tribe was eliminated, so it responded by joining his uncle's tribe and becoming a valuable member of his uncle's tribe. If you respond effectively, the empire will grow. Then, if that tribe was attacked by other tribes and they responded effectively, the empire would grow again. As it grew, it would clash with other tribes and kingdoms. There would be conflicts. And if they reorganized and responded effectively, they would grow again. This would continue until they could no longer had the will to respond. Of the last 26 civilizations in history, 25 collapsed from within. The great civilization is the American civilization. And they all collapsed from within because they became weak. They collapsed as Rome collapsed with bread and circus, welfare for the masses, buying them off with massive taxes on the productive, until finally they weakened from within, and the barbarians came from outside and took the city, and the Roman Empire disappeared. In our lives, every time we effectively respond to a challenge, we grow stronger, more resilient, more confident, and more powerful. So the only thing we can be sure of is that challenges in your life will be an ongoing series. They'll come like waves in the ocean, problem after problem after problem. The only question is whether we can effectively respond. And if you do, you keep growing. As soon as we stop effectively responding to life's challenges, we start collapsing inward. So every time you face a challenge, just say, well, here we go again. This is what I do. I effectively respond to challenges. And the wonderful thing is, I learned this in metaphysics. Make the decision that no matter what happens, you will respond effectively. And program yourself in advance that no matter what happens, you will respond effectively. No matter what problem you have in life, you take and accept responsibility to respond effectively. If you make that decision in advance, when the problem occurs, it's like they press the automatic button and you're already geared up to respond effectively. You don't even have to think, what should I do in this situation? You just respond effectively. You don't get angry. You don't get sad. You don't cry. You don't take it out on other people. What you do is say, it's a problem, so we respond effectively. We move forward from here. Very, very important. This attitude is the attitude of a leader. Civilizations grow and decline to the extent that they face challenges and respond effectively, just as individuals grow or decline to the extent that they face challenges effectively. The three areas of life where responsibility is essential, first, are in the political realm. The more you vote for politicians to do things for you, the more you give politicians control. And unfortunately, every civilization in history has chosen politicians who promise to rob Peter to pay Paul. And as they say, when someone promises to rob Peter and pay Paul, they'll always have Paul's support. Basically, this is modern politics in the Western world today. Japan has almost collapsed because of this. Most other Western countries are in a state of bankruptcy or collapse because politicians are too weak not to give people what they want, which is free money. So every time you vote for someone who promises to give free money to other groups, remember, they'll get it from you. And what happens is that the less money you have, the less power you have over your own life. The second area has to do with the economic world. The economic world is where you become an economic adult. As an economic adult, you take control of your own career. You make your own career decisions. You don't wait for someone else to give you a job and a place to sit and tell you what to do and what not to do. You see yourself as self-employed. You see yourself in charge of your own personal career. I write about this regularly. I make books and articles about it because there are a lot of people going through unemployment. And what they do is go from hat to hat saying, like, please hire me. Please give me a place out of the cold. Please give me money for something. Instead of taking control of their lives, they look to someone out there who's supposed to be responsible for them. And this just makes you a child. And you shift the focus from your parents' childhood to your boss. And your boss becomes your new parent. And the third area is health and well-being. Many of us don't take good care of our bodies. We expect the doctor to take care of us once we get sick. If there were no doctors, or if you were in a place where doctors were very hard to find, you would probably take much better care of your health. But responsibility, taking control of your life, is very important because there is a direct link between responsibility and self-esteem. The more responsibility you accept, the more you like yourself, and the more powerful you feel. On the other hand, the more you blame your problems on other people, the weaker you feel, and the less you like yourself. They both decrease together. High responsibility, high self-esteem. Low responsibility, low self-esteem, low self-confidence, low potential to achieve everything you want for yourself. So we say the important key is this. You're always free to choose the quality of your emotional life. You're always free to choose the quality of your emotional life, your physical life, and your financial life. Now, this is pretty remarkable, isn't it? It's your choice. Barbara and I realized this many years ago. Our daughter Christina confronted us and said we couldn't watch her all the time. We were setting boundaries, rules, telling them what to do and to call us here and everything else. You can't watch over me all the time. I'm going to make my own decisions. You just have to trust. You've raised me well enough. And we said, all right, from now on, make your own decisions and we'll support any decision you make 100%. That has become the mantra in our family. Any decision you make, we support you 100%. I have a little joke with my kids. I tell them I've never forced them to do anything, and I've never forbidden them to do anything, and they have to agree. I've never compelled them to do this, and I've never prohibited them from doing that. Unless, of course, they want to spend vast amounts of my money, in which case we'll just have a longer conversation. But I've always encouraged them to make their own decisions. I don't always agree with their decisions, but I always back them 100%. And most of the decisions they've made have turned out to be very good. It's amazing how right their decisions are when they're responsible for making them. Would you agree with that? Would you agree? Okay, my son is here, and he told me not to mention it, so I won't mention that he's here. I won't mention that my son, Israel, might be sitting right next to you. You never know which chair he's in. Well, you're always free to choose the quality of your life. You're always free to make your own decisions, and that's important. Does that mean you always make good decisions? No, but you always know they support you 100%, and there's nothing more wonderful than knowing the important people in your life support you 100%. Does that mean you always make good decisions? No, but you know they'll back you 100%. And you know if the decision doesn't work out, they'll change that decision very quickly. It'll be reversed very quickly if it's your decision. As we come to the close of this speech, I urge you to carry forward the insights and revelations gained here today. Remember, knowledge without action is merely potential, but knowledge applied is power. Take the wisdom you've received and let it ignite a fire within you, propelling you toward your goals with unwavering determination. Remember that you hold within you the power to shape your own destiny, to create the life you invest in. So, embrace the challenges that come your way as opportunities for growth, and never forget the immense potential that lies within you. Thank you for joining me on this journey of exploration and enlightenment. May you go forth with courage, confidence, and an unwavering commitment to becoming the best version of yourself. Everything in life and business is about relationships. Your ability to form the right relationships with the right people at every stage of your life and career will be the critical determinant of your success and achievement. The more people you know and who know you in a positive way, the more successful you will be at anything you attempt to accomplish. Goals of any kind. You will need the help of lots of people. Who are they? You need to develop a strategy to work effectively with each group. Start with your business. Make a list of everyone who works inside and outside of your business. Your boss, your colleagues, your co-workers, subordinates, and especially your customers, suppliers, and vendors. Which of these people have a greater ability to help you or hurt you in the achievement of your business or career goals? I then point out that everyone is in the business of customer service, no matter what they call it or what they do. A customer can be defined as anyone who you depend upon for success and advancement in your job or business. A customer can also be defined as anyone who depends on you in any way. For example, your boss is your primary customer at work. Your ability to satisfy your boss will have more of an impact on your future, your income, and your career than any other single action you take. If you displease everyone else but your boss is delighted with you, you'll be safe and secure in your job. If you please everyone inside and outside your company but your boss is unhappy with you, that problem alone can short-circuit your future. One of the best strategies you can use is to make a list of everything that you believe you have been hired to do. Then take this list to your boss and ask your boss to organize this list in order of his or her priority. What is most important to your boss? What is second most important? What is third most important? And so on. From that moment onward, discipline yourself to work on your boss's top task all day long. This will do more to help you in your career than any other single decision you make. 86% of the senior executives selected two qualities as being more important for career success and advancement than any others. First, the ability to set priorities, to separate the relevant from the irrelevant. Second, it was the ability to get the job done fast, to execute quickly. There is nothing that will help you more in your career than to get the reputation for being the kind of person who gets the most important jobs done quickly and well. But the sad thing is that if you do an unimportant job very well, this could actually hurt your career and even threaten your job. Be sure that what you're doing today is still your boss's top priority, then make a game of doing it fast. Your coworkers, who also depend on your work, are your customers as well. Go to each one of them and ask them if there is anything that you can do to help them. The fact is that people think about themselves and their own jobs all day long. You should look for every opportunity in your work to help people and to do nice things for others. The more the people next to you, above you, and below you like you and support you, the more you'll get paid and the faster you'll be promoted. Look for ways to be a valuable resource to the people around you, and they will automatically look for ways to help you and support you when you most need it. Perhaps the most important quality you can develop for long-term success in your business is that of being a good team player. To be a good team player, always come prepared to every meeting, sit opposite and in direct eye contact with the person who's running the meeting, speak early and ask questions, volunteer for assignments, and when you offer to do something, do it quickly and well so that it is clear who the go-to person is in the company. As a result, you will be given more and bigger jobs and both the authority and the rewards that go with those jobs. Take time to get to know your subordinates and the people who are below you on a corporate ladder. Offer to help them if you can. Be especially kind and courteous with them. Go out of your way to compliment them and to recognize them for their work. You will be amazed at the difference this makes in your career. In every organization, the person who knows the most people is usually the person who, like cream, rises to the top. Outside of your business, you should get involved with your industry and your industry associations. Look at the business organizations in your community. Once you've decided that it would be useful for you to be a member of one of these organizations, join up and begin attending every meeting. Here's the best strategy of all for networking. Select an important committee within the organization and volunteer to work on that committee. Once you join the committee, volunteer for assignments. Even though this work is unpaid, these activities give you an opportunity to work with and perform before other key people who can help you in your career sometime down the road. The more people that you know and work with in your industry, the more doors of opportunity there are, that will open for you when the time is right. As you read your local newspapers, make a list of the top people in your community. As you gather these names, write each of them. Write a letter and send them something that is non-business related. Send a copy of a small book, poem, a newspaper clipping, or anything that might be of interest to them based on what you've read about them in the papers. Each time that you see a reason to communicate with that person, drop them a note. Often, I don't get through or make direct contact, but I continue to sow seeds, and sooner or later, what goes around comes around. Eventually, I will end up meeting a key person socially or in business, and they will remember that I dropped them a letter a week, a month, or even a year ago. No effort that you make to expand your contacts will ever be completely lost. Some will yield results immediately, some will not yield results for many months or even years. You must be prepared to be patient. Make it a point to associate with the kind of people that you like, admire, respect, and want to be like sometime in the future. The choice of a positive, goal-oriented reference group can do more to supercharge your career than any other decision you make. At every turning point in your life, there is usually someone standing there guiding you in one direction or another, opening or closing the door for you or helping you in some way. If you're really serious about being the best and moving to the top of your field, you cannot afford to spend much of your time with people who are going nowhere in their lives, no matter how nice they are. You must set high standards for your friends and associates and refuse to compromise. Your choice of the people you associate with will have more of an impact on what you become than any other single factor. The third category of people whose help and cooperation you will require are your family and friends. It is absolutely vital that you invest all the time and emotion necessary to build and maintain a high-quality home life or relationship. Life problems at home distract your attention and drain your energy. They can often sabotage your career. Throughout your career, you will be required to go to what are called deliberate extremes. You will have to work long hours and often many days without breaks or vacations in order to take advantage of an opportunity or to complete a project. Be sure that you discuss these deliberate extremes in advance with the members of your family so that they understand what is happening and why you are doing it. Always treat people with kindness, courtesy, and compassion. Above all, the simplest strategy is to treat everyone you meet at home or in work like a million-dollar customer. Treat the other person as though he or she is the most important person in the world. Treat them as though they were capable of buying $1 million worth of your product or service every day. In every way, look for ways to lighten the load and help other people to do their jobs and live their lives more easily. Now, here are three things you can do immediately to put these ideas into action. 1. Make a list of the most important people in your work and business life. Develop a plan to help each person in some way. 2. Make a list of the most important people in your personal life. Determine the kind of relationship you want to have with them and what you will have to do to achieve it. 3. Identify the groups and organizations in your community and your field that it would be helpful for you to join. Phone today and arrange to attend the next meeting.